Without further ado, I'm here to introduce our next speaker, Tony Chicotel. Tony is a native of Cleveland, Ohio, and is a graduate of Ohio State University College of Law and the University of California School of Public Policy. Early in his practice, Tony worked in Las Vegas representing people in mental health facilities. You can imagine it might be pretty exciting being in Las Vegas representing people in mental health facilities. Tony moved to California and over the next 6 years worked as a staff attorney in a program providing free legal services to older adults in San Diego County, where he was also lead attorney in their nursing home rights enforcement program. For the past 4 years, Tony has worked as a staff attorney for CANNR, California Advocates for Nursing Home Reform in San Francisco. In 2006, he received the California Lawyer Magazine Attorney of the Year Award for his work in elder law and nursing homes. Tony's turn-ons include going from first to third on a hard hit single, vigorous applause, and the Golden Gate Bridge. His turn-offs include the designated hitter rule in the American League, half-hearted hugs, and locked door facilities. So let's give him a big round of applause.
Okay, I'm going to try the wireless mic here. Hi, everybody.
Hi.
I have a nose full of amyloid. I have a terrible cold given to me by my kids. Another funny joke. When I go home today, someone will say, well, how was your day? And I'll say, well, I was given some scenarios about featuring a 76-year-old Filipino woman, and I became passionate and aroused. those were my markings. I noticed earlier this screen over here wasn't doing so well. It looks like it's doing okay now. Is that okay? Because I'm starting to develop a wolf pack theory for projectors and screens. I do a lot of presentations, and sometimes there's multiple screens. And almost always the one in the middle is really bright, sharp, and then there's one on the side that's like, you know, 10 years ago, the old model, and it's outdated, and those people feel relegated. I think we're doing okay now. All right, on the time, can someone keep track of time for me? And give me like the halfway, can you give me a halfway? Because I have so much to cover, I'm really scared about getting it done. And I have so many ways to offend you that I have to get through. Well, let me start by, on a positive note. These are my two baby boys that gave me this cold. Yeah, they're super cute, aren't they? I mean, I know I'm their parent, but geez. How do I get any work done? So this is Reggie, and this is Cal. They're twins, they're identical. And I like these pictures, and for some, I think they're wearing the same outfit, actually, which we never do, but it just sort of worked out that way. They've begun walking, but doing this. Am I really doing this? It's really fun. Here's what I plan on talking about today. And I allotted myself 10 minutes to party. Well, for all of us to party. We're not going to make it. I'm not going to finish 10 minutes early, I don't think. But we'll see. If we do finish early, we'll party. My primary goal today is to talk about the drugs and then the law regarding the drugs and then maybe a different approach. And it's sort of a dilemma. I'm a lawyer. I come at this from a lawyer's perspective. I've sued nursing homes for misusing psychotropic drugs on their residents. I'm very civil rights oriented. This all I ever wanted to do with the law is fight for the small person, the person who's underrepresented, out-resourced, and help balance the power a little bit. But over the years, I've done some presentations with some really amazing speakers, and they've rubbed off on me, and it's hard for me to just focus on the law anymore. What's that? Oh, need more volume?
Yeah,
okay. Yeah, I'll start shouting if I have to. And what I found is, it's not just about being anti-drug, it's about replacing the drugs with something else. And it's all about being curious and investigative and creative and coming up with responses to what we perceive as behavioral distress. And it's really, I live in Berkeley, it's all about love. It's about loving these people the way I love these two, the way we all love our children. And trying to figure out what they're telling us when they're crying or showing distress. Okay, so real quick on the drugs, five classes, and you heard my turn-ons and turn-offs, so you know I'm a baseball fan. So I like to describe the drugs as a baseball lineup. You want your leadoff hitter to be somebody who gets on base all the time, so that they can be driven in, someone who's fast, high on base percentage, and that's my antidepressants, because I think they're the most used psychotropic drug, at least in the long-term care setting, antidepressants. Then you've got the number two batter, somebody who doesn't get a lot of publicity, has to be real handy with the bat, be able to lay down a bunt, be able to move, hit it to the left side of the infield, move a guy from second to third. That's my hypnotics, the sleeping drugs. My number three batter, this is a lot of times in a lot of lineups, this is your best hitter. It's just sort of someone who can do it all, hit for average, hit for power. That's my anti-anxieties. In a lot of facilities, long-term care facilities, and with some doctors, it's the drug of choice for sort of instantaneous subduing. And then you got your number four here, your Babe Ruth in the psychotropic drug lineup, the antipsychotics, the heavy hitters, the big boppers. They swing and they miss, and sometimes they connect and it goes over the fence. Heavy hitters, and lots of examples there. And then, this is sort of new, my number five batter, the anticonvulsants, which is really Depakote and a few others. Okay, some numbers. Over 56% of all nursing home residents in California receive a psychotropic drug. And the way the federal government classifies it, it's only one of these first four classes. The fifth class isn't counted as a psychotropic drug and under the federal classifications. So it's probably higher than that, but it's over 56%. That actually represents progress. 4 years ago, it was about 60%. So the numbers are edging downward, and I'm actually kind of stoked about that. And by the way, I'm really stoked to be here. This is a large group. I get really excited. I turn on include vigorous applause. The deal with antipsychotic use, 83% of it in nursing homes is off-label, meaning for dementia. It's not FDA approved for the use of dementia, but that's more often than not how it's used in the nursing home setting to control behavior associated with dementia. And number three, nearly all psych drug use. In my experience, it's almost always to do this to somebody, to compress them. That's why I love stages. To compress. It's to stop whatever was happening from continuing to happen. Most often. For antipsychotics, there are really, really heinous side effects. The list is too long. I have to say, et cetera, et cetera. It's like 30, 40 things. You've seen the drug commercials where for 5 seconds, somebody's having a good time and they're saying, oh, use this drug, and then the next 25 seconds is side effects. That's kind of the way it is with antipsychotics, specifically for older people with dementia. Lots of side effects, including anticholinergic side effects, which could actually exacerbate the symptom or the behavioral distress that we were seeing, ironically enough. And everybody responds differently, so a lot of times that doesn't happen, but for a lot of people it does. But the big one here is it nearly doubles the risk of death for somebody who's older with dementia. And that's why the antipsychotics have an FDA black box warning label that people in nursing homes and assisted living facilities don't necessarily see, because they get their pills in a little white cup. So they never know, they're never told about the black box warning. A couple years ago, my organization sponsored a bill that would require nursing home residents and if they have decision makers, substitute decision makers, make sure that they're told about the FDA black box warning label and the medical industry opposed it because they said, you know, why practice medicine legislatively? I'm just going to throw this out there really quick. I apologize. It's sort of a teaser. Well, there's a lot of there's a robust literature debating whether or not these drugs are more harm than good for elderly people with dementia, but there's an increasing academic debate about whether they're effective for the FDA-approved purposes. Do antipsychotics help reduce psychosis? And there's a journalist out there from the Boston Globe named Robert Whitaker who wrote a book called Anatomy of an Epidemic. A couple years ago, Marcy Angell, A-N-G-E-L-L, did a big story for a two-part series for the New York Times Review of Books, the New Yorker Review of Books, where she talked about three current books that were raising this issue of, if these, we're giving out these drugs more often than we ever have before, if they're working, how come the rate of disability associated with these diseases has gone up? Why aren't they reducing the incidence of disability? They're not. So there's this whole debate going on. Why are antipsychotics associated with increased death for elderly people with dementia? It's because they make them less active, generally. They stop moving, they stop exercising. That's, I think, the biggest part of it. It's not, and there's increases cardiovascular events and strokes and things like that. But I think the main reason is just less activity. I think another big reason is because you've eliminated, if you're eliminating the behaviors that you're observing, which can seem like a good thing, you also might be taking away the person's ability to communicate when they're having trouble. So if they're no longer crying out when they feel pain, you aren't going to know they're in pain, you're not going to medicate the pain, you're not going to find what the source of pain is, which might be a preventable disease or illness. We've known about these dangers for a long time. The FDA black box warning label has been around since 2005, but the and antipsychotic use for people with dementia actually went down in the community after the black box warning label came out, but in long-term care settings it went up. Again, the consumer is disconnected from the black box warning labels usually because they're not getting they're not picking up the prescriptions from the pharmacy. So it continues to go on. Why? There's tons of reasons, more reasons than I could cover. And I've tried. I do a blog on the CANA website about dementia care. And one of my first postings was called Anatomy of a Drug Problem, where I tried to tackle the many facets of why we have an overuse, I think an over-reliance on psychotropic drugs in long-term care facilities. Doctors, there's not a very strong physician presence in nursing homes. A lot of people are surprised about that. I've been to, 75, 80 nursing homes, spent quite a bit of time there, and I swear to God, I have yet to see a doctor in a room, in a resident room. I see them at the nurse's station frequently with stacks of medical records, but I just don't see them in the room, and that's what my clients tell me. We don't really see our physician. And, you know, physicians, when they get called in the middle of the night sometimes and there's a resident in trouble, they're not going to come down there and try to figure out what's going on and resolve the problem that way. They've got the one thing. It's a prescription pad, and they're going to use it because that's what the caller wants. That's why they're calling a physician. That's when I do these trainings for people that work in long-term care facilities. I say, you got to get somebody to call before you call the doctor. Somebody who it becomes a dementia care, an in-house dementia care specialist. I think there's lots of, I don't want to say blame, but there's lots of reasons why this happens, including the advocates. I've been fortunate enough in the last few years to work with some really well-known national advocates in long-term care issues. And on this issue, they've been asleep up until a couple years ago. We were asleep on this. There was a big push on physical restraints about 20 years ago. And I'm sure some of you are familiar with that. And the rates in California went down from like 20-something percent. Now we're down to 3%. Nationally, it's less than that. I mean, California is actually about double the national average on physical restraints. So this enormously successful campaign And what they should have anticipated, this was a little before my time, is that there might be a move into a different type of restraint. And that's kind of what we see happen, although the correlation isn't quite that clean. There's a lot of money involved here, folks. Tons of money. Billions of dollars on the psych drug use, particularly long-term care facilities, such that big pharmacy companies have displaced the military industry as the biggest defrauder of the federal government. That happened about 2 years ago. So the pharmaceutical industry now pays more in penalties for fraudulent activity to the federal government than the military industry did. And for, you know, that was a generation of military fraud, defense spending fraud. Remember the $150 toilet seat or whatever it was? Now we've got the $240 monthly prescription of Risperdal that was unneeded. But the main reason why I think as caregivers and people that care about people with dementia, boy, I really want to sit in one of these chairs, they look comfortable. Somebody turn up. The Giants play a day game today, right? I can watch this. Actually, I think I get to sit in there next for the panel. The main reason why we rely on these drugs is because we don't know what else to do. It's really simple. We don't know about our alternatives. So I'll talk about the law a little bit. And if I get boring, I'm sorry. But they asked me to talk about the law. And most of this law is nursing home related stuff, but I think it's applicable, and I'll talk about some places where it sort of becomes generalized. But the nursing homes, they love to tell, especially in Sacramento, we are the second most regulated industry in the country behind the nuclear regulatory industry. So they're well regulated, and there's lots of I think, pretty good laws here. This is what I'm going to talk about. Okay, informed consent. Informed consent, it's a nursing home law. In California, there's a regulation specific about nursing homes and informed consent. But this is generalized to everybody. Nobody can put pills in our mouths or in our applesauce without our consent. Does that make sense to y'all? We have autonomy rights, the rights to control our bodies, the right of privacy. In California, that's actually codified in the Constitution, the right to privacy. So from this right to privacy comes this notion of, well, nobody can alter our brain chemistry unless we are told what that is all about, and we're allowed to ask questions about it, and then we ultimately give consent or we refuse it. So the informed part of informed consent is known about the risks, the benefits, and the alternatives. The consent part is about saying yes or no. And I'll say this, anybody who will listen, people with dementia and people without dementia who are just older are oftentimes totally ignored in the informed consent process because they're considered to be troublesome decision makers. I actually think that informed consent isn't well maintained for any patients. I think there's studies that bear this out, but my own experience with doctors is that they oftentimes don't really, they'll give you some basic information, but they don't ever really ask yes or no. They just say, this is what you're going to do. And I guess, you know, it's different for everybody, for every physician. But regardless of capacity, this is a really important concept legally. Even if doctors have declared somebody with dementia, let's say for example, as not having the capacity to make their own decisions, whether or not they take a medication, they always have the right to refuse. Nobody can force a pill in their mouth unless somebody goes into court and asks the judge to take away their right to refuse. Because really the right to bodily autonomy, about 90% of it, is really the right to refuse. Like, stay away from me. The right to be let alone is... Supreme Court Justice Brandeis famously said. Did he famously say that? Do you guys know what I'm talking about? The right to be let alone? Justice Brandeis and the Olmstead case in the early 1920s, I think. Oh yeah, I'm a law nerd. I read the Brandeis biography a couple years ago. It's like this thick, and it took me like a year, and I kind of regret it. It wasn't that exciting. A real quick note on surrogacy, because I think it's really relevant to a lot of people in the room. For people who have lost the ability to make their own decisions, somebody's got to exercise the consent rights, and that's usually a surrogate. It's always going to be a surrogate. And that could be a conservator, someone who goes into court and gets a court-appointed conservatorship, someone who is operating under an agency authority, under a power of attorney, or just family members. If there's none of the above, the default in California generally is family members. Although if there's more than one family member who wants to decide, we have some problems, and you might end up in conservatorship court. And surrogates can consent, but they cannot override the right to refuse. The patient always maintains the right to refuse unless you specifically go into court and take it away. In California, in the conservatorship process, the law that allows you to do that is Probate Code Section 2356.5. I know a lot of code sections. Yeah, Probate Code 2356.5. I think it's going to keep that change. The duty of informed consent. It's a physician's obligation to get informed consent. If they don't, they're in trouble. Although, in reality, not so much. But if I find out about it, they're in trouble. They could be. And nursing homes have a separate duty to verify that informed consent has been obtained. So nursing homes can't just say, oh, we have a prescription here for this medication, let's go ahead and give it. Particularly on psychotropic drugs, they have to talk to somebody, the physician, him or herself, or preferably the resident, or the resident's decision maker, and say, have you been given information? Have you provided consent? And then they can go forward with it. A lot of facilities use a form to sign for informed consent. And I think that's a good way to document the process. I don't think it's a good way to conduct the process. RCFEs, for people who aren't, professionals in this stuff, that's assisted living facilities. Facilities that aren't nursing homes, they don't have a 24-hour nurse presence, but they take care of people, a lot of people, particularly with dementia. Do they have a duty with regard to informed consent? Not specifically, but I'm a lawyer, and I can think of some. Especially for facilities that are actually injecting themselves into the doctor-patient relationship by making the call and saying, I've noticed this in this resident, can we get a medication? I got a real good one a couple months ago where the facility operator was calling the doctor multiple times saying, sundowning, 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 we need a pill. And the pill was prescribed. In those situations, I think there might be some duties regarding informed consent, but these are just legal theories of mine, untested as of now. So the question is this informed consent? This is a form that somebody signed. For Zyprexa, this is from a nursing home record, and it says, "It's for Zyprexa. This medication is designed to relieve you of your symptoms." What? Sounds really nice. Research and clinical experiences have shown that it is safe and effective. Wow. The benefits usually outweigh the risks. Well, they've done the analysis for you. This isn't about informed consent. This is about getting someone to sign. So I call this neglect, meaning there's been some provision of information. I think it's neglectful provision of information, but there's been a signature. So there's been consent. We don't really have them on the big bopper, which is battery, meaning they've agreed to take the pill, but I think it's neglect. Actionable neglect. This is a doctor's order from a different nursing home for Risperdal Consta, meaning they can give it to him as a shot because this guy was refusing it in the pill form. 25 milligrams every 2 weeks. The reason, there's an arrow pointing up, increased episodes of elopement. He's trying to go home. If you heard this guy's story, which you will, you're going to be upset. So this guy lived a couple hours south of here, and his wife was taking care of him. It was just him and his wife. And he had dementia, and he was declining, and she couldn't take care of him anymore. And she went through this very long emotional process of deciding what to do, and eventually decided that she was going to put him in a nursing home. The nursing home encouraged her and her daughter, who was really involved with the care too, to not visit for 2 weeks, because they said it would be disorienting to them. They would be there sometimes and then go away. And I think clinically, that to me, that just sounds bad, right? I mean, I think that they could have maybe softened the transition rather than made it worse. So they were encouraged not to visit, and the guy was totally confused, and all he could think about was, I gotta get out of here. This isn't my home. I'm going home. So, and he was real a physically active guy, real totally ambulatory and physically vigorous. So he was constantly, pushing out the door. So they wanted to knock him out. And they got a physician order to do it, Risperdal. They didn't talk to the family. They didn't talk to the resident. In 3 days, he developed a really bad infection, high fever. They were reading him his last rites, and that's how his family saw him. So they to the nursing home. Several days later, they get a call. He's being rushed to the emergency room. He's being read his last rites. This is a pretty heavy-duty situation. That's not informed consent. That's battery. That is basically taking someone and knocking them down with your fist. It's a legal equivalent. So in the nursing home situation where there's regulations about no unnecessary drugs, and I just want to give you a flavor for how unnecessary drugs is determined. And it's, we're looking at the dosage and the duration and the monitoring and were there indications for use and were there adverse consequences. I don't want to, if you're interested in learning more about the indications for use clinically from the federal guidance, here's the internet link. Here are the inadequate indications for use. So if this is what the drug is for, it's not enough per the federal government. Wandering, increased episodes of elopement, poor self-care, you can see if it's just this, it's not enough. So in a non-nursing home setting, what are we talking about liability for care partners, care providers, facilities related to the drugs, unnecessary use? Well, I think from the physician side, there's malpractice for sure. And there's potentially elder abuse. I wanted to give you the definition of elder abuse. It's an expansive definition. It's something that lawyers really like. It includes other treatments, so any kind of anything. I used to do get elder abuse restraining orders for clients down in San Diego, and it was remarkably easy because all you needed was conduct, any treatment that annoyed or alarmed or harassed a senior, and that was pretty easy to prove. Any treatment with resulting physical harm, pain, or mental suffering is elder abuse. So I think that's potentially in play. No chemical restraints, that's a prohibition in nursing homes, and I think that's something that's generalizable to the population as a whole. No chemical restraints, and this is how the feds and the states and the state of California define chemical restraint. And for years I've heard, well, we didn't do it for discipline or convenience, we did it because it was clinically needed. They were having these distressful symptoms and we wanted to make sure that it was taken care of. If you had been here, you would have seen it and you would have approved. But what I focus on is not required. The drug must have been required to not be a chemical restraint. If it was not required, it's a chemical restraint. So if there were any alternatives that might have worked, it couldn't have been required. So my definition of chemical restraint is a little more expansive than others, particularly those in the nursing home defense industry. What? He's on Medi-Cal! I'll never get paid. A gradual dose reduction is required in nursing home settings too, but I think clinically it's recommended practice, anywhere. That the presumption should be, we're on the drugs, and it should be our last resort, and if it's our last resort, we should make every effort we can to get rid of it. And so the federal law places, in nursing home settings, places a presumption that we're going to get rid of it. And the way we're going to do it is by gradually reducing the dose and eventually eliminating it. And the only way we're not going to do a gradual dose reduction is if it's clinically contraindicated, meaning the doctor says, no, this is a really bad idea. They've been on this drug for 20 years. We've tried dose reductions 15 times. They've never worked. This is the only thing that's worked. They're doing okay. Let's leave it on. But every other case, it's supposed to come down and eventually be eliminated. How am I doing on time? Okay. Sweet. We might party. We might party. You got the music ready? I don't know why I assumed you would have the music. You're running the cameras. It would be cool if I had music right then. Just saying. Okay. So I'll talk about alternatives to drugs, which is really becoming really what I'm all about when I go to work every day. I take a lot of calls from disgruntled residents and family members who aren't happy with long-term care or the providers. And I take calls from providers, too, and I'm happy to do that. But really why I get up every day and go to work is to try to improve somebody's life, the quality of life for somebody. And that's what this is all about here. The federal law really sets up this notion that drugs are to be used last. So the laws are really good here. They're protective. They talk about we set up barriers and we're allowed to decide what goes in and out of our bodies. And the physicians have to inform us about what we're taking and the risks, the benefits, and the alternatives. And we have to understand it. And we have the right to be free from chemical restraints. And we have the and gradual dose reduction. The drugs should be sort of a last resort. And I never say that, you know, the appropriate drug rate in California nursing home should be 0%, because I don't believe that that's the case. I believe that in the short term there can be useful situations, and I definitely think in the long term, for people who've been on these drugs for a long time and have diagnosed mental illnesses, to take away the drug is actually really irresponsible without doing something else. It's always about doing something else and substitution. But I think that the rates can come way, way, way down from 56%. You know, I think that's still way too high. The antipsychotic drug use is about 22-23% now in California. A couple years ago, it was 25. So we're making some progress. So from a clinical perspective, you always want to rule out any other potential physiological problems. Pain, dehydration oftentimes looks like dementia could cause behavioral distress. You want to look at the sleep. You want to look at are they active? Do they have healthy human relationships? Are people talking to them? If no one's talking to you, you might get kind of lonely and you might start doing weird things just to get attention. So you want to take a good look at everything that's going around, the environment, their experiences. I was reading a New Yorker article about one of my heroes, Tina Alonzo, came out a week ago or two weeks ago, and they had their staff at their facility actually wear an adult undergarment and you know, wet themselves, and then sit in it for a couple hours, and feel what that feels like. And they also had someone who spoke a language that they didn't understand come and provide care to them, and try to explain in the nicest voice possible what they were doing, but then just do it. And they also had someone brush their teeth and wash their face, just to get that what the idea is like. And I've heard of other seminars or trainings where people smear Vaseline on glasses and they put stones in their shoes and they're made to feel really uncomfortable and then have someone jab a toothbrush in their mouth and start going away. It's disorienting. You might go like this, despite what anybody's explaining to you. So I know it sounds so simple, and it is. Think about it from their perspective, what's going on, and that will explain a whole lot of what you're seeing as behavior. And not maybe a symptom of a disease, but just sort of a symptom of being human. Okay. BPSD, I'm on a hate campaign against BPSD. This is behavioral and psychological symptoms of dementia. That's sort of the clinical term for people screaming at night, or hitting somebody who's trying to provide them care, or not, you know, taking a bath. behavioral and psychological symptoms of dementia. Cal and Reggie, I love them. When I'm up in my room, we have this little carpet, this little blue carpet, and sometimes they might get upset and I sit there and cry. I don't say, oh, wow, behavior and psychological symptom of being a baby. So when you start thinking of things in clinical terms, you start thinking about clinical responses, and you start thinking about medicines. Oh, man, Reggie, I don't see there's anything wrong with you. You must have some sort of disease, some brain disorder. Maybe if I give you a pill, it'll balance that out. Of course we don't do that. What I do is I pick him up. If that doesn't work, I embrace him. And if that doesn't work, I rock him. If that doesn't work, I stroke the back of his head. Or I like to tweak his hamstrings a little bit. Tweak, tweak, tweak. Have you seen people in nursing homes? Tweak, tweak, tweak. Is it your diaper? Are you hungry? Is it your teeth? Is it pain? Are you cold? I feel if he's wearing a short sleeve, is the skin on his arm warm? I go through everything possible. And, 99 times out of 100, we get it. He stops crying. It always comes down to staffing levels in long-term care facilities. If you've got the staff who can do that, it gets done, and we don't have to resort to drugs to get them to shut up. How do we do that? This is the core principle of Tina Alonzo and her facility, the Beatitudes, and it makes sense to me. People who are comfortable, if you're feeling good, you're not going to hit anybody. If you're feeling scared and confused and disoriented, and people are coming at you taking off your clothes, you're going to hit. You're going to protect yourself. You're going to bite. You're going to act crazy and do whatever it takes. You don't know what's happening. Get them comfortable. It's the key. They've earned it, right? Least medicating. That's what I call my approach. And I have a t-shirt that says least medicating. I believe in it. And the principle is the use of the drugs represents a failure. And I'm not saying that when every time the drug is used, it's wrong. And that's not what that says. What it says is there should be a recognition that it's because we haven't figured out what's really going on. The drugs don't treat dementia. They don't take away the plaques and the tangles. They don't make people better. They don't make people happier. They take away the communication of the distress that was causing the symptoms. So the idea is, we try to figure it out, we're only human. We can't always figure it out, and sometimes we got to do what we think we got to do, and that could be a pharmacologic agent, and that happens. We recognize that it's because of our own inability to figure out what's really going on, and it happens, even with the best experts. This is a quote. Why it's in quotation marks. It's congressional testimony from 1975. This has been going on a long time. In the late 1980s, there was a whole lot of bad publicity about nursing homes, and the federal government ratcheted up the regulatory structures, and they implemented all those rules about clinical indications, informed consent, no chemical restraints, gradual dose reduction. They put the principles in place 25 years ago, and we're just now seeming to rediscover them. But we're getting there. I'm really proud to say we are getting there. Things are starting to shift. And it's a real hopeful time. I think all around, the Alzheimer's, the dementia research is starting to turn around. Almost every week I read something in the newspaper about a development, and it seems like they're closing in. So it's sort of like a two-pronged attack. One is on the prevention front, and the other is on the care front. And eventually, people's lives will improve. So my organization is really dedicated on this issue. I'm 100% dedicated on this issue. If I were fired today, I would continue to do what I do for as long as anybody would let me do it. We have a website, the campaign to stop chemical restraints in nursing homes. We have a guide for consumers, for non-attorneys, non-professionals, called Toxic Medicine, What You Should Know to Fight the Misuse of Psychoactive Drugs in California Nursing Homes. We beefed it up a little bit this past, about 6 months ago, to include more discussion about non-pharmacologic options and interventions. These are my summary points. This is what I want you to take away. My information should be on the first slide. Is it on the first slide, my contact information? Damn. Okay, never mind. Don't contact me. It was intentional. No, so I work for California Advocates for Nursing Home Reform, eminently Googleable. Googleable? You can Google me. Yeah, you could do that. You'll get some weird stuff, too. I swear that's the other guy, named Tony Chicotel. My email address, it's really simple, T-O-N-Y. You know why all the guys that are Italian are named Tony? Ooh, that's even worse. Because when we were leaving Italy, they would stay up to New York, bam, right on our forehead. T-O-N-Y. Only an Italian can tell that joke, by the way. So it's Tony, T-O-N-Y, at canhr.org. C-A-N-H-R.org. C-A-N-H-R.org. The only way I ever really learn is to hear from other people. So I'm letting you know, feel free, any questions you have about anything I talked about, even if you want to argue with me, I'll jump right at death threat. I'm a daddy now. No death threats. But if you want to argue with me, that's cool too. That's the way I learn. I don't think that everything I say is totally correct, because the stuff I said 2-3 years ago wasn't totally correct. I know it's an evolving process. C-A-N, like can of tuna, H-R dot O-R-G. All right, with the iPad. Whoop, whoop. Leave you with images. So, this is the image that I had. There was one nursing home in the Sacramento area in particular. I walked in one time, and this is what I saw. Just chaired, slumped, totally disengaged, and it was like 2 p.m. It shouldn't have been like this. And I had an epiphany. For years, I would go into facilities and see people like that and think, oh, how sad, they have dementia. And this is what people with dementia look like. And then that was the first day where I realized it wasn't the dementia that made them look like this. It was the drugs that they were taking to treat the dementia that made them look like this. And that's not a way I want to look. This guy, that's the way I want to look. Damn! To put down! This is a YouTube video. I'm sure some of you have seen it. I can't remember what it's called. It's some music program where they go into nursing homes and they put I wish it was this simple. They put iTunes on for people with the headphones, and they find out what music they like. And this guy was pretty frozen. He didn't talk to anybody, didn't engage. He put the music on, and boom, he lights up and he becomes talkative and he remembers things that he didn't remember before. That's connected. And they run, like when he's talking, they throw up his words. I feel a band of love, of dreams. Woo-wee! That's the way I want to feel. I don't want to feel like that. I want to feel like this. And it was the difference was, for this guy, somebody trying to figure out what would do it. In his case, it was music. It's not going to work for everybody, but in his case, it worked. But that's it. That's all I got, I think. Yeah, thank you very much.